Chapter 61, verse 1. Read with me, please. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners.
That we will rise again, for I believe in the Seated. We're going to have offering and have the ushers come forward as I read this verse. This verse comes from Ephesians 5, verse 1 through 2. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you that you love us so much that even when we make mistakes and do things in our life that are not shining of your glory, Lord, that you have mercy on us and you forgive us. And you hold our hand and you say, come with me. It's not the end. You have not failed yet. I love you. I'm taking you with me. And I thank you for that, Lord. And I just pray, Lord, today that as the service goes on, Lord, that you'd help us to open our hearts and to really be touched and moved by you and challenged to do things in our life for your glory, Lord, to live our lives fully for you, to honor and please you in everything we do and say. Thank you so much, God. Bless this offering. In Jesus' name, amen. Message right now, so the kids can come up here. What are they saying? They're having problems in their relationship.
What happened to your glasses?
What happened to your problems in their relationship? Well, who is that? That's Rat's brother. And Rat.
What?
What's Rat's brother's name? Rat? That must have been kind of confusing for their mom. How many of their brothers were named Rat? They're all named Rat. Well, what's the problem with their relationship?
Well, they fight just about everything.
Like what?
Like being
like where they're going to go dumpster diving. Like who's going to sleep and who's going to bring in the food. They're just having general problems with their relationship. Even what they watch on television. I didn't know rats watch television. Why do you think the television's always on in the morning? I never thought about it. I thought maybe someone got up and watched it. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of rats in the living room watching television all night long. Oh, great. So they have a relationship problem. Yeah, and I just really don't know what to do about it. I don't know how to help them. Well, maybe the kids can help you. When two people are having a problem with their relationship, kids, do you have some ideas on what they could do?
Mm-hmm. Yes, Christina?
Hot dogs and hot wings.
What?
Hot dogs and hot wings.
Go out to eat together?
Yeah, of course.
And just talk? Yeah. Good idea, yes.
Talk about their problems.
Get together and talk about their problems? Uh-huh. Is that what you were going to say?
No, they could draw straws.
What do you mean draw straws?
Like who gets the longest straw?
Oh, when they're arguing about who gets this or that, just draw straws, okay? Any other ideas on how they can help each other with their relationships? Anybody got some ideas? Yeah? Barbie, did you have an idea?
Yeah, have a meeting and work it out if you have a problem.
Get together, each of them, and have a meeting and work it out?
Like an emergency meeting, work it out if you have
that. Uh-huh.
You want a relationship to grow, which is broken. Talk it out. Get some help.
That's uh-huh. Get some help. Talk it out.
Talk it together.
Uh-huh.
You can heal what's broken.
Yeah.
I have a relationship that's broken myself.
Uh-huh. Good. Well, and that's what you're going to do, right?
Yep.
Good. Good. Yeah, that's good advice. I was wondering what I could do to help them. What could I do to help them? Anybody know what Tommy could do to help them?
Tommy, you can.
Yes?
He forgot.
Okay. Any ideas on what Tommy could do to help him? Huh?
Tommy, you could tell them that you don't like the arguing and talk to them together if you need to.
Okay. Get together and talk to them. Do you have any ideas, Tommy? Well, I was wondering about it. Well, the first thing I thought I'd do is I start praying for him. You prayed for him, and I asked God what I should do to help. You did? Well, that sounds pretty good. What did the Lord say to you? He said, I should talk to each of them and get them together and try to help. Try to help them both. Listen to what's going on and try to help them. Well, that sounds really good. So to be a peacemaker, Jesus talks about being a peacemaker. That means helping other people to get along. Yeah, that's what I thought I'd do. But, you know, I don't know much about being a peacemaker. I don't know much about counseling and stuff. You know, you don't have to know a lot. You just need to care a lot, and they both need to know that you love them.
But we have a much problem.
You have what?
We have a much problem.
Lots of problems? Okay. Okay, yeah, they do have lots of problems, don't they? Yeah. I think I'll try that. Hey, you guys. Rat and Rat. Can we get together and talk about your problems? What'd they say? They said they'd had trouble with their. What did they say? They said they had problems with their relationship, but that they both like me and maybe I could help them. What did they say? They said that maybe I could buy lunch for them both. Well, okay. Hey, you got some money I could borrow for lunch? Okay, that's a good cause. You can borrow some money to take them out to lunch. Where you guys want to go? They want to go to McDonald's. McDonald's?
Come
on. Yeah, McDonald's. How much is it going to cost? They said it won't cost anything because they're going to have lunch in the McDonald's dumpster.
There's a dollar.
Oh, they're going to have lunch in the dumpster. Well, that's pretty cheap. I'll pay for that any time of the week. Yeah. Okay, well, you can get together and you can work your problems out. Kids, remember that if you have friends that have problems, be a peacemaker. Get together with them, talk to them, show them that you care, and maybe get them together and help them work out their problems, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, God bless you. You have a really good day. You can go to kids' church if you want to. Or you can go back and be with your parents.
A peacemaker.
Yeah, be a peacemaker.
Mm-hmm. I love peacemaker.
Mm-hmm.
What is it? What is a peacemaker?
It's a person that helps out each other people get along. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
practicing my steps. But what about you yourself? You've greatly improved.
Well, I've been doing the same thing, practicing my steps. And you know, the amazing thing is that when everybody takes the responsibility to practice their own steps, things really come together nicely, don't you think?
Yes. We need to take this show on the road. You want to go dancing tonight?
I don't think we're ready for that yet. Let's go practice some more, okay?
Oh, okay.
Well, this is the last in the series about relationships, and today is helping others in their relationships. I'm sure glad that couple worked out their problems of stepping on each other's toes and worked on their own problems and got together, aren't you? So I was afraid that was going to be a kind of a split in our church here. Don't know why they decided to do it on Sunday mornings, but that's just, you know, they're really good people, and I just thought I'd put up with it a little bit, you know. Really, helping others in their relationships, and when I thought about that, I thought about Joe and Michelle Williams. Well, we'll ask them to share this morning, but Michelle can't because she's got laryngitis. But Joe is going to come up, and I'm going to ask him a couple questions and just share, because they lead a ministry called Marriage 91, Reconciling God's Way, and that's what they've focused on for many, many years, is helping married couples get together and work on their relationships. So. Not sure. Where Joe? Where is Joe?
Over there.
Oh, there he is. Okay. Usually sits over that way. I was looking for you. Come on up, Joe. Why don't you share some of your experiences and some things that you've learned over the years with helping people in their relationships. Now, I know that we're talking mainly about marriage, but any relationship, I think some of the principles would apply.
I don't know if you got enough time for me. You know me.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, we got enough. We got plenty of time.
Everybody in here pretty much knows me, but for the ones that don't, I'm Joe, and I just want to thank Pastor here for the opportunity to say a few things. And thank a few people. We've been doing the ministry here for a couple years now, and Michelle and I did it in the beginning.
You can go up here and speak right into the.
I can speak real.
No, speak right into here. Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's good.
Anyway, so now that when we go to the different churches, and we've got a ministry now that spans the United States, the Virgin Islands, Africa, Canada. We just opened up a ministry up there. There's three churches in that area, Alberta, Edmonton. And we were asked to go to the Virgin Islands. Can you believe that there's marriage problems in the Virgin Islands? That's what I said. Hey, no way. We don't have to go to the Virgin Islands. That's paradise.
I didn't know that they married down there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh,
okay.
Okay, all right. Okay, anyway. One question to ask Pastor. I was talking with Jim Yardy when I came in today, and he looked at me. He said, "Hi, cowboy." And I said, "Hi." He says, "You know the difference between a Texas cowboy and a California cowboy?" And he looked at me. He said, "No, what?" I said, "Tennis shoes." Anyway. So anyhow, I want to thank Bruce and Diane for helping out. She is kind of headed up the marriage ministry, and I kind of made a mistake this last, it's kind of funny, I thought it was funny, kind of stupid, my part. But I went in to the class to kind of set in incognito, that I was just going to be there just in case, you know, I wanted to work with the guys at a table if they needed help at a table, and I wasn't to be known. I'm sitting there, and the first thing that they do in that class, of course, is put up our videos where Michelle and I talk for 8 minutes, and I'm sitting there, and the guys are around my table, and I'm sitting there going, "Oh my goodness, I just blew it, and it can't be a secret here." Anyway, so I'm going, "Okay, all right." So they. Because I didn't want to get in there and you'd be the expert. Because give her a hand right now, because Diane and Bruce, because they are very good. She does the money ministry as well. What's that called?
Financial
peace ministry. Okay, yeah. And so, anyway, Pastor asked me to share what brought us into this ministry, Michelle and I. Well, because we were people of the world for years. She was a very good hairstylist, had two or three hair salons, woman of the world. I was a man of the world. I worked with sales. You know salesmen. Bernie knows car salesmen. I was one. So, you know, forgive me. Anyway, well, car salesmen, there's a lot of Christian car salesmen. I don't know very many, but there are. Anyhow, coming together, we were separated and divorced. She was in Alaska. I'm here in California. We got together, and of course, we fell in love. Sorry, Pastor. Facts are facts, truth is truth, right? And because of that, we had issues, okay? We brought in all of our luggage into this relationship and marriage, and we went through a lot of trouble. Like the comedian once said, you know, we've been married 10 years happily, too. Anyway, got to think about that one. Anyway. So we went through a separation, and I finally went to this book right here, the Lord's Word. I started studying and reading. And after about a year of studying the Word, I raised the Bible in my right hand. My wife sent somebody to my front door, Michelle. We've been in ministry now 20 years. But before that, we were people of the world. I had a friend of mine knock on my front door where I was staying and handed me divorce papers. I took the divorce papers into my front room, and he was sad he had to do it. And I was sad that I had to take the papers. And I held the Bible in my right hand and the divorce papers in my left hand. And I held them up and I said, God, I've been doing the things, I've been following people. They've been giving me suggestions for years. And all the suggestions that I get from them has led me down this path. You got to show me who you are. I said, God, I'm going to do what you want me to do in this Bible. And what I read in Malachi is that God hates divorce. He loves the institution of marriage. But he hates divorce. He hates the paper it's written on. He hates the churches that allow it to continue without doing anything about it. And why do we want to do something that God says that he hates? I find this ubiquitous in all of our country today. Marriage is under a tremendous attack. So I took those divorce papers, and I took them, and I walked back to my bedroom, and I put them in a chest of drawer, and I never touched them. I never touched them. I went to the Word, and I studied the Word. And about a year later, after I got those divorce papers, we were getting back together. It wasn't because of me. It was supernatural. She had met people. She had gone to the Lord. But we still had issues. Marriage is a lifetime of issues. Anybody here going to raise your hand and say that it isn't? Anybody raise your hand and say that it is? A lifetime of issues that we deal with, okay? Anyway, so that started us on this path. And then people started saying, well, how did you do it? How did you do it? So we were kept up. We would get phone calls at midnight from couples. Michelle would get a phone call. Michelle, I need your help. Tell me, my husband's doing this, how did you, I would get a call at midnight. So after about we're slow learners, so after about a year of that, we finally said, hey, we can't do this. You know, we have to put something down in paper. We have to write something down. And so we started writing our workbook, and we went to the church every Sunday. We started a class called Reconciling God's Way, and we would write a chapter. And then we would put it to the class, and the class would read the material, and then they would critique it. So we made a lot of mistakes. We had several educators in that class, and one day a guy raises his hand and says, Michelle, I got a question for you. And she says, what? Well, he says, right here, he says, I just wanted you to know that Moses didn't spend 40 years in the desert. Well, anyway, so we made our mistakes. you. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Anyway, so the class critiqued our marriage, Reconciling God's Way. Then we it morphed into 911 because we were doing conferences and we met the National Institution of Marriage, which is a larger organization which has now morphed and gone with Focus on the Family. And Focus on the Family published a book of ours in 2007 called Yes, Your Marriage Can Be Saved. And we threatened to write another one with how the world is treating marriage. You know, we keep threatening to write a book called No, Your Marriage Can't Be Saved, Now Get Over It. But we're not gonna do that, okay? But anyway, marriage is under attack, okay? And so, in a nutshell, that's kind of how we got into the marriage. I got a couple of verses here that, first verse that I studied was Exodus chapter 18. And it says, I'll read it to you real quick because it's pretty easy to understand. And I would implore you, I would suggest, read this chapter. Because Moses led the people out of Egypt. He was anointed by God. And when you come to church, when you come to church on Sunday morning, this is holy ground. Okay? You're stepping onto holy ground, consecrated ground, this church to God's work. Out there is Egypt. Now that's my mindset. Okay, you can think about it any way you want, but when you walk into a church, I feel that's holy ground. And when you walk out of that church, you're walking into Egypt today. Okay, and Moses left Egypt with, you know, about 2 million people, 600,000 foot soldiers and their families and kids. Now you can imagine that they're there for 400 years in Egypt. You've established your roots, right? Okay? And you're walking out. And so there's a rabble of people that are following you because this multitude of people are leaving. So let's go where they're going. They're going to have fun or whatever, you know. And they're taking all of our gold and silver and all that stuff with them. You know, and they're leaving. So they're out there. Now you can imagine, you've established your roots in Egypt. Now, what's going to happen? You got the soldiers there. They used to, you know, soldier during the day and go home and have food at night, you know, start their barbecues or whatever. But now they're in the middle of the desert. Do you, and you know, and their wives are following them and their kids are following them. Now, they're following camels and donkeys and all that stuff in the middle of the desert. It's 130 degrees. Do you think they're going to have marriage issues? You know, women, how would you like to follow your husbands out to the desert out in Mojave and walk, you know, and follow a bunch of donkeys and camels? You'd probably have some marriage issues. So, Moses was counseling. This is what this chapter is about. He was counseling all these people, 2 million people. They were lined up from morning until night. And he was counseling these people about all their issues, about God, about issues, okay? And Jethro came with his wife and kids and watched him. And he walks up to Moses one day, verse 17, and says these words. So Moses' father-in-law said to Moses, "The thing that you do is not good." Did you hear me? A man walked up to Moses and said, "Moses, the thing that you do is not good." Now, how would you like to be that man that had to tell Moses, who would touch you with a stick, you could become a snake. You could probably turn to blood or start running water. So you had to believe God had to be with you. God had to be with Jethro. Okay? So Moses, being a wise man, okay, what do you mean? Jethro said, "Well, the thing that you do is no good because you're going to wear yourself out." And Moses said, "Okay, what should I do?" And Jethro says, "Choose people that have two qualifications. They fear God and they love the truth. And start a ministry of reconciliation. Build your teams from your tribes." Now this right here is your tribe. This church is your tribe. We were at several other churches. We started several other ministries. That's their tribe. But choose people that fear God and love the truth, because they will come and share the burden of the people with you. That's one of the reasons why we do this ministry. It's not only to help people, to help marriages survive in times of tribulation, but also they help the pastors. Here's another thing it says. Verse 22, Exodus 18. And let them judge the people at all times. Then it will be that every great matter they shall bring to you, pastor. Okay? So it will be easier. They will judge the small things, the teams. Okay? For they will share and bear the burden of your people with you. It's a team, not only to help people, but to help your pastor survive. Because he can't do it all. There's a lot of pastors that think they can, but they really can't. So verse 23 is very key in Exodus 18. I read this and it just blew me away. If you do this thing, God says, if you do this thing, Jethro's telling Moses, and God so commands you to do this thing, then you will be able to endure, and all these people will go to their homes and places in peace. Well, that's the nutshell of why I said, we got to start a ministry. You know, not only do I believe it, not only God calls us to, but he commands us to, and we got to help the pastor, and marriage is under attack. It's been under attack for a long time. And we, as the people of God, need to stand against the attack. I mean, we got to be an ear. You know what it says in James chapter 1, verse 19? What's it say? Go ahead, somebody out there. You know what it says. All right? You've studied along. You know it says what? Be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. But you got to be an ear. Pastor says, you know, we got to help people. He's got the mindset that we want to have relationships and help people. And that's what we need. But we also need to do it God's way, not Joe's way or not Pastor Brock's way. You know, not Jim's way. Goodness, he's the best hamburger cooker I know over there. But, you know, we're not going to cook up any relationships. Anyhow. But we got to do it also. God's way is a simple way. Now, does anybody here, you know, I was trained at Sears Roebuck to be a salesman. I was trained at Montgomery Wards to be a salesman. Anybody know the, you know, when they taught us the KISS system. Anybody here know what that means? Huh? Who said that? What?
Keep it simple.
That's right. Keep it simple what?
Stupid.
Ah, that's what they taught me. Okay? So you keep it simple, stupid. If you're going to sell something, you're going to sell a refrigerator. When they say, I want it, stop talking and write it up. Right? Okay. But that's not what God says in his word. See, the world has taken the word of God and has used it to make money with. Okay? God says in 2 Corinthians... Verse 1, for our boasting is this, the testimony of our conscience, that we conducted ourselves in the world in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God and more abundantly towards you. Now, also, he backs it up. Chapter 11, verse 3. Of 2 Corinthians. But I fear lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. So it's not keep it simple, stupid, that they taught me. The world teaches you. It's keep it simple, saints. Keep it scripturally sound. Okay? That's what we do. And another great book that was written that I call the Nike book, that a company has made billions of dollars with. Anybody here know what the Nike book is? Huh?
James.
Who said that? Boy, teacher over here. Of course you would know it. The book of James. Right? Why is it the book of James? Because in chapter 2, what's it say? Don't just be a hearer of the word, but be a doer of the word. So what does Nike logo say? Just do it. And they've made billions of dollars with God's word. They take it and twist it and pervert it. We got to bring it back, and we got to know that this is holy ground. This man stands up here and he preaches on Sunday. He pours out the living water of God. We got to quit damming it up in our brain and walking out of here without a change. We got to have that water flow through us, get down our back to our backside so we can get out to the door side and do something for God that's out there in Egypt and have that protection, because that's what is happening to marriage today. But that's why we serve to help. We serve to help you. We serve to help marriages survive. And I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for the opportunity to share. And is there any questions? I'll be happy to ask any questions on this ministry at all. And this is a great opportunity because normally I'm up here with my wife, and she does most of the talking, and I obediently sit back and listen because I know this country humor, you know. It's clean, so I got to say it, though, for Jim's sake. You know, I've seen it written on a wall, in a plaque, and it said, if men would learn to treat their wives like thoroughbreds, they would never become a nag. Anyway, I just wanted to... Okay. You got to think about that one, right? So I laughed, and I used it, and then the last thing I'm going to say is I work with the men. We've learned that. We, Michelle and I, don't counsel couples because they just get us into trouble. We make mistakes. That's not our calling. She works with the women. Our team is set up that way. Teach churches is set up that way. And I always tell a guy, because they always, a guy come to me and say, when we get them, they're hurting. And they need an ear. They need James 1:19. But I always say these words to him. I says, three times in a man's life, he'll never understand a woman. And man, their ears pick up. Boom. Oh, you know, tell me. I got to know. Three times in a man's life, he'll never understand a woman. That's before, during, and after marriage. We were not designed, I tell them, to understand a woman because we did not design the woman. We were designed to understand God. And if we understand God properly, then we'll be able to deal with the woman. Okay? Same goes for the woman, but I just deal with the men. So that's where I start with the men. You got to understand God because that's how God created you to understand who He is. Okay? Amen?
Amen.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to start out at slide number 6, so if you switch down to that slide number. I want to read some scriptures. I knew he was going to take some time because this is on his heart, and if he took the whole time would be fine with me because I kind of planned for it. But I'm going to go a little different direction, although my slides will kind of go along with it. I want to read some scriptures about helping each other. John 15:12, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And I think the thing that caused you and Michelle to get into this ministry is you saw broken people and out of love, just like Jesus did on the cross, out of love, you're willing to put the time and the energy and the sacrifice to help someone else. And that's God in us. That's how God works. And we do that. Romans 15:1-2. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the feelings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. It's so easy to be the church when all we want to do is attract people that are already strong in the Lord or have no problems. That's not the church. I don't want to be in a church where we just get together and have a holy club and we enjoy each other and we all think the same and do the same. That's not the church the Lord made. The church made the body of Christ, he said, so there are those that are going through difficulties, who are weak in different areas, and we're all strong in some areas and weak in others, and we want to help each other.
and love our neighbor. You know, and so if the Lord has blessed you in some way, use that strength to help somebody else. Galatians 6, 2 through 4, carry each other's burdens, and this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. And I think about what happened with Ian, an incredible burden for the Hagler family to try to, you know, for this young man to go from running around here at church to where he has to crawl and learn to talk again and all this, and then them going back and forth. And I really think our church stepped up and helped bear that burden. Now, I know we can't bear the burdens of the whole world. We're not Jesus. Jesus did that. But the Lord said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly of heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The yoke that Jesus has for you is just right for you. So the person that's in front of you that God has put in your path, there's an opportunity there to develop a relationship and help them. And we carry each other's burdens. Now he's talking here mainly, earlier in Romans he's talking about our neighbor, which is, you know, he defined the neighbor in the parable of the Good Samaritan. The neighbor is not someone who's just like you. It's the person that's different than you. The Samaritan was the one who reached out to the Jewish guy that got hurt. So that's someone different than you. Your people that are in the world, co-workers, etc. Here he says, carry each other's burdens. He's talking to the church, that we carry each other's burdens in the church. Philippians 2, 3 and 4, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. There's a way that we help people, and there's a way that we don't help people. We don't help people when we think that we're way up here and they're way down here. But when we look at ourselves no different than the person that we're helping, except that we've got a channel to the Lord, who, and the Lord is helping us, that's when we really, really can help people. And my own story about helping people is I've never felt real comfortable with the counseling part of being a pastor. I felt more comfortable and more called to the lead them to Christ and help them to follow Jesus. I've never been as comfortable with helping someone with problems that they were having in their lives. But that's part of the territory. That's part of what you do as a pastor. People don't come to my door and say, oh, every day and say, oh, I just need Jesus. That happens very rarely. What they do is I've got problems, I need help, and then I point them to Jesus who can help them with their problems. So, but I've never felt comfortable with that, and I had a class in counseling in seminary, and the teacher taught all the different kinds of counseling, but not how to do them. Did you know that there's a type of counseling that actually you just actually shock people? There is. I can't remember what the name of it is. I'd probably flunk the test now. But I'm not going to use that kind of counseling. And then there's what they call Rogerian counseling, with which all you do is just parrot back and rephrase what the person said to you. Maybe some of you have had those kind of counselors. There's all these different kinds of psychological counseling and stuff. And so we had a class in counseling, but I never had anybody mentor me or show me how. And I think that would be helpful. But you know, the interesting thing about it is years later, I had come across this, and that some studies had been done that showed that lay people who have no training in counseling are actually even more effective than people that are professional counselors. And I was thinking about quoting that today, and I thought, well, I better make sure that that's really true. It's not just something that I picked up. So early this morning, I was in there, and I looked it up online, and there's a study by Liberty University. They looked up every study they could find on lay counseling and the effectiveness of it, and they studied 42 studies. These are scientific studies, controlled studies, social studies, valid studies, and they all showed that lay people not only were equal, but were superior to professionally trained counselors in helping people. And we're talking about church people here, okay? We're not talking about outside the church. This is in the church. I think the Lord might have something to do with that.
And let me tell you what I'm learning about counseling, and it applies directly to each of you. I've got a couple I'm counseling right now, and it's incredible what God is doing in their life. Saving their marriage, helping them spiritually. And to begin with, I was reticent because I a lot of times refer counseling on to professional counselors. Youth for Christ has a great counseling center here, Christ-centered, and some really good counselors. And I usually don't counsel over a period of time. I refer people on because I don't really feel qualified to do it. I haven't had a lot of formal training in counseling. But I felt the Lord leading me to establish a relationship with this couple and counsel with them. And the amazing thing about it is every week I just said, Lord, what should I talk to him about this week? Boy, that's pretty simple, isn't it? And it's incredible that every week it was just nailed right on the head what they were going through, what we needed to talk about, what I had to share with them to help them. And most of what I drew from the Word of God. Principles from the Word of God are right directly from the Word of God, mostly just principles from the Word of God. And they say, this is helping us so much. And I know they're thinking, boy, I'm such a great counselor. But the fact of the matter is I'm not a great counselor, but I have got an incredible God, and if I'll just open myself up to Him, there's amazing what He can do. Amen. And I'm saying, I think that probably you're the same place I was. You're thinking, oh, these problems that this person, these couple, or that these people are experiencing are so great, I'm not going to be able to help them. But I'm telling you, you have a channel to God, and there is no better counselor in all of the universe than the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit knows their thoughts. The Holy Spirit can lead you and help you. And if you will humble yourself and not depend and trust in yourself, and you will just trust in the Lord to use you, the studies even show it. You can be more effective than that $100 an hour counselor that I was maybe would refer them to, or you would refer them to, and certainly a whole lot better than that $200 or $300 an hour psychiatrist who's been trained in all the godless philosophies of the world. So I want to encourage you. I know each of you have people that you know. You've got kids that are going through trouble. Love them. And let the Lord speak through you. And sometimes I just listen. And sometimes I ask questions, and sometimes I say, this is what the Lord is saying to me that I need to tell you. You need to listen to this. So it's not just a listening ear, but a listening ear is a lot of it, and the Lord can give you a listening ear. So what I say is there, and I concur with Joe, there is an incredible marriage problem in our communities, but we have got even greater than that. We've got relationship problems. We've got marriage being defined as whatever you think it might be. And pretty soon in this country, we're going to have polygamy and all kinds of things because we've basically thrown out God's definition of marriage, which is a man and a woman joined together by God and blessed by God in a covenantal relationship. We've thrown that out. And so everything goes, and I'm telling you, it's not getting better. As you know, it's getting worse. And that's not the only relationship problem we have in our society. We have a problem with, this is what I've noticed. I've talked to young people that are dating and so forth with people in college and stuff. It is hard to find a young person. If you're a young person today and you're say 18 to 25 or whatever, and or even into 30 or whatever, if you're a young person today and you're wanting to find a spouse and you're looking for someone who was raised in a healthy home, who's not psychologically messed up, it is hard to find anybody. There are so many young people that are just messed up. Not just if they were raised in a home that's where the husband and wife are together, it's usually a messed up home. Their values are just messed up. I feel sorry for them. It's hard to find a healthy person. So what you got is you got young people getting together, and they have to learn to be healthy first. Like,
Bill and Mary. They got to learn their own step before they get together, but they're not, and so they get together, and you got two unhealthy people getting together, and it's just a mess. So there's all these relationship problems and problems in the family, more than there ever were before, and I think the reason for it is because as our society has decided that this God thing is not part of what we want to do, there are results, because the moral laws, which are laws of relationship, they're laws that God laid down when he made man and woman, humans. And you break those laws, you're going to get burned, just like breaking the law of physics. You can't stick your hand in the fire. So they're breaking these laws and they're suffering the consequences of them. But the church is the kingdom of God come into this world. The church is the power of God come into this world, into our lives. And so rather than throwing our hands up, what we want to do is take our hands and get our hands a little bit dirty. Get involved in someone's problem personally, just like Jesus got involved in your problem when he hung on the cross. Trust in the Lord. And here's some things, very simple things that I think that we can do. Slide number 8. Find someone to help. Form a deep heart-to-heart relationship to them as a friend. Support them when they go through difficult times. And what I mean by that is listen to what they have to say and encourage them. As you look on them, look at them with the eyes of faith and say, this is what I see you becoming in the Lord. This is what I know God's will is for your life. It's not to be where you're at right now. God created you for something better, and this is what I see. Encourage them. Find someone to help. Look at God's leadership in your counseling. Ask him what to do, and just do what the Holy Spirit says for you to do. Take a risk. Try it. Say what he says for you to say. Pray for them. Ask God to show you what to say and how to encourage them. Have faith for them. Our faith carries other people's burdens and lifts them up. And finally, connect them with other people and other resources to help, because we don't have to do this alone. We can do this together. And that's one of the reasons why I like the Marriage 911 ministry. There's two huge reasons. One is they tell everybody, you need to take control of your problem first. Which, if you get two people that are looking at changing themselves or looking to the Lord to change them, it's amazing what can be done. So they focus on that. The other thing is they use lay people in the tables to be support partners and helpers and encouragers and that kind of thing. And the need is so great that all we have to do is put out the sign and people call the church. That's amazing. I don't see people calling church for anything else, but the financial and the marriage ministry, the need is so great that people are just looking. They're looking for someone to help them. But I'm telling you, we have the answer. Not in us, but in Jesus. Jesus is the answer. And we can point them to Jesus and to the Word of God, and he can help them. Now, I know that everybody makes their own decisions, and some people don't want to be helped, or they can only be helped as much as they're willing for the Lord to help them. But have faith for them. Give it a try. Find someone to help in any way that you can. And it's amazing what God will do through our lives. And you know what? I think if we open up our hearts and our minds, God will put someone into our sphere of influence that we really can help their relationship. Has already perhaps already done that. The worship team is going to come and lead us in a closing song, and I know in a sense I've opened up a lot of thoughts and ideas and so forth, and maybe some of you even have someone that you are really concerned about. If you want to use this altar as an opportunity to pray for someone else, or to pray for a relationship today, that's been the focus of the message. Or just if you want to meet the Lord here, the altar is open on this last song as we sing. You're welcome to come here and pray for a while. And if you want a pastor to pray with you, you can stay after we're dismissed today. But let's stand and let's sing this last song as we close our service. And may the Lord use you this week to touch someone's life, to help someone's relationship. Thank you.
into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to develop my life through your eyes. I'm captured by your holy calling. Set me apart. I know you're drawing me to yourself. Lead me, Lord.
Incredible area of need in our families, in our society, isn't it? Let's pray. Let's look to the Lord. Lord, we need your help. We know that you are powerful and that you can speak to people. Lord, use us to help to be peacemakers, to help other people in their relationships. And Lord, mold us and use us to change us, make us more like Jesus every day, we pray. In your name, amen. Now go out and